Nydia, is there anything I could help you with? How about you, Chris?
I think I'm good. I'm gonna.
So you got everything charged and ready to go?
Yeah, I think I'm set.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. It seems like we have put out an expectation in this room. It seems like it doesn't fit. So if you wouldn't mind, we may have the portion like right outside the building. So we can use the indoor area, and we're going to move these chairs to outside, if you wouldn't mind. So that way, we'll come over the next session. Okay.
Somebody, it's a 3 or 4 page document. We had about 200 copies. We had no idea how many people were coming, so we need to print more. Or if you go to the website, if you go to facebook.com and go to Shady Shores, you can find us and sign up and sort of jump in on the conversation.
I can't hear what's going on over. I think they're going to have mics.
Sign the sign-in sheets before you leave. Thank you.
Practice over there and I manage a temple over there. Can everybody hear me now?
No
one have a megaphone or anything?
Yeah, I think they went to go get one.
Okay, good. Thank you. I thought I heard a pretty loud voice because I sing in the choir, but I guess, you know, with the wide area, it's kind of dispersing very quickly.
Yeah, stand up on the hill and maybe everyone can hear you.
Okay, that would be nice. Thank
everyone can hear you.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Can you hear me better now?
Yes.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Glad to hear that. Thank you. So my name is Sumal Satoor. I'm a gastroenterologist. I practice in Evansville, Indiana. I used to live here in Atlanta up until 2013, and I moved to Evansville and started my own practice. The reason that we are all here today, of course, is because we are thinking about a facility here where everybody can come and have and enjoy the peace of the property. So having said that, have to have something to anchor it, and a temple would be anchoring this property where it would be like a religious services performed, no animal slaughtering, no cruel services here. There will not be any fishing, any swimming. It's going to be peace, meditation, calm, and serenity. That's what is the motto for this place. That's what we are actually planning to have. And let me give you a little background as to why we even considered this proposition, right? Because there are so many things to do for a place. Why do we have to do a temple? So this is where it started. In 2007, I had a very difficult time in my life that I went through a painful divorce. And divorce is a stigma in Indian community, and it still is. In my parents' no one got a divorce. They lived no matter what. But when my ex-husband had an affair, I had to put my foot down and said, I am an Indian woman, but I respect my marriage. I want my spouse to respect my marriage. If he doesn't want to respect it, so be it. I don't need that spouse. So at that time, he chose that he wanted to go with the other woman, which I had no problems with. But he left, and I was left here, 35 years old, with two young children, didn't know what to do. It was a shocker. And my family, everybody kind of alienated me because divorce is a stigma, right? So they didn't want to take the blame with me. So when I was going through that, it was difficult. So I was just looking for a small lake cottage to hide in on the weekends just to get some peace and quiet. I came here looking for a property, and I ended up seeing a small property on the lake. And we were just heading back with the realtor, and the realtor was talking to me about an investor that actually owned this place and that place and many other places on the lake.
And she said, you know, he had another place here, which is a horse farm. And my father was a veterinarian, and I actually wanted to be a veterinarian, which he didn't allow me to. So I ended up being a human physician instead of a veterinary physician. So I was kind of interested when she said that. So we came here. It was a Friday evening. It was a crazy Friday. My schedule was packed, and it was like such a difficult day. Then I came here, and then I had to meet with the realtor at the end of the day. So I came here, and when we got out of the car, I felt the peace. All of a sudden, I'm not rushed anymore. I'm not stressed anymore. I was just calm. It was quiet. And it was serene. This is September somewhere around that you're thinking about. And there was like these fall leaves all around the property, and it looked really run down because the ceilings were off, and there's no kitchen. There was no plumbing fixtures, nothing. So when I saw that property, I was like, but that peace of this property is what caught my attention. I said, this is rare. You don't see it everywhere. So this is something very unique about it. And I liked it instantly. And I asked her how much it was, and she gave me the figure. And that was way beyond my budget. I'm a single mother, two young children, 6 and 9 years old. I said, I can't afford this property. There's just no way. So I'm not even trying for this. So I said, forget it. So I put a bid on the other property, which wasn't in my cart. So the guy asked for more. So I said, okay, fine, you know. I had to go out of town because it was a fall break time. I already had a trip planned with the kids. So we left out of town. When we came back, actually the realtor called me again. And when she called, I asked her, as a matter of fact, when we were talking about the other one, what happened to this one? She said, what happened to that one? I don't know. Let me check. So she pulled up the property, and it was, by the time in these 2 weeks that I was gone, the property was foreclosed, and it was brought into my budget. So she nailed me down. She said, it is in your budget now. Are you going to bid for it? I said, yes, right there. We bid for it, and we got it. It was difficult to get a loan because no one got a loan for this property. There's no kitchen. It's not a livable property, so no one got a loan. So it took me like three pulling effort to get that loan, and I never renovated a house before. This was my first one. All the friends and everybody kind of gave me my colleagues and my patients helped me out to find people. Who does the sheetrock? Who does electric? Who's general contractor? Who does what? So they helped me to put this place together. But coming here, actually spending the weekends here, like even just renovating it, spending time here, actually helped my mind to come back to the balance where it used to be. And I started my MBA at Georgia State, and then eventually right after, while I was about to graduate from the MBA, is when I met my husband now. He came from Evansville. He wanted to meet me. He's a surgeon. And we liked each other. We got married. And then the question was where to stay. We followed the husband. That's what everybody said. I said, okay, fine. I went to Evansville. So I was thinking, you know, this property came to me. I don't know what the deal was. It just came to me, and I renovated it, and I just rented it. Felt like the house was sitting here waiting for me to come. Always felt like the house should be happy. People should be in there living and being happy. So I rented it out. So last year, what ended up happening, actually the year that we went to Evansville, we were trying to find a house, and we walked into a property, and it looked like a perfect one for the temple because I felt the peace over there too when I went there. So I talked to the community, and we got a temple together in that place, and there are several people that come in, not everybody every time, but like, and I see like maybe three or four people coming and going, and whenever I just pass by them, they say, oh, this place is so serene. I was so stressed when I came in. I feel so much better now, and thank you for having this place here for me and for us. I'm like, hey, this temple is going to be here, but I'm just here for my lifetime or for however many years that the good Lord gives me here. He gave me work here. I'm happy to do that, and thank you for getting that opportunity. I'm blessed. I'm beyond blessed when it comes to that, because I'm just a mundane human, okay? I'm just a mother. I manage my little family, you know, kids, their education. Did they eat today? Did they have enough clothes to wear? Do I need to buy them winter clothes versus summer clothes? I mean, my brain is wrapped around this, and I don't know why the good Lord just pulled me out of that and said, you need to do some community service too. It's important for you to do that. Here is the work, and he gave me the work, and I'm happy to do it. It makes me feel like a better person doing it. Having said that, last year, I got a call from a friend, a neighbor here, who's my friend. Actually, when I came to this place, everybody actually opened their arms and literally hugged me. I could not believe it because my colleagues and everybody said, You're going to Cumming, that's the last place where the KKK marched, and you're a colored woman. You're going over there? Please don't.
Come on now, we don't need to go there.
I know, I understand. This is what they said. This is what they said. This is exactly what they said.
Let's get on with the meeting. Let's get on with the meeting. We don't care about it. Don't trust me to win the race. Let's get out of that.
Please let her finish. Everybody will get their chance.
Let her talk.
Please let her finish.
Don't be rude. Be quiet.
But I came here and I felt the peace, and the neighbors were so friendly, and they were all became my friends and family. At the time when I came here, my family estranged me, and these people around me, Mike, Ron, Robert, Pat, around there, Ramon, they opened their arms and they hugged me, and they became my family all of a sudden. And I had a huge family. Prior to that, I had two siblings. I'm the oldest of the three. And my parents and my extended family. But these people, I can go to any of their houses anytime. I got stuck on the driveway one day when it was like snowed a little bit, and I just went and knocked on the door of Ramon. Ramon came and dug the driveway out and got me out of the driveway. And I got stuck one day with my pickup truck in the back, and Mike came and he actually pulled the truck out for me. I mean, all these neighbors, they opened their hearts and they opened their arms and they hugged me. And I felt like this is my home. So I never felt anything different than that since then. So one of my friends, my neighbor, called me and said, I'm going through a divorce. I need for you to buy this property for me, this small piece of property next to it. And she was explaining to me what she was going through, and I was crying and she was crying. We both, because I walked that road. I walked in her shoes. I can tell exactly how much pain she's going through at the time. So we both were crying. And she said, I have to go. I really have to go. I can't stay in this. I have too many memories. I have to go. And I was thinking, you know, had my house, in my there was a tenant living here with his kids. So had my house was empty, I would have let her stay here for however long she can to regain the peace. But then I can't, because it was on a contract. I didn't have the heart to let a family that came to here to spend 3 years to go. So I couldn't do anything. So at that time I thought, Lord, you know, I wish, you know, she had the opportunity that I had, and to do something. And at this point I was thinking about it. Then my husband was diagnosed with thyroid cancer, so I was busy taking care of him and getting the surgery done and all that stuff, so I didn't think much about it. So it just put it on the back of my mind. But in December, when the tenant called and said he was having a hard time and he has to break the contract, and he asked me if I could let him go, I said, okay, fine. You know, I didn't hold him onto the rent or anything that was pending. I said, if you're having a hard time taking money from you, trying to get the money from you, is taking money out of beggar's bowls. I don't need that.
So
I really don't need
that.
So let go. So once that happened, so I said, you know, I'm not.
We're going to get a chance to stand up and tell you about our lives.
Yes.
Yeah, I want an opportunity.
So this is the reason that I'm talking.
The facts.
We want business. Church, business.
The case that you made about the neighborhood and how you felt is why we're here tonight.
Yes.
Let her finish. Kick it. We got so everybody.
What did she say?
I don't know.
You want her to just keep on talking about buying the house and all that? Let's get to the point.
The meeting has to be over.
It's
going to
rain.
She said,
so we all
we got.
Here,
we got so. After 7 o'clock because
we
weren't ready.
Okay. Yeah.
So,
yeah. I know it's a contentious issue, you guys, but let her say
it's
her
not,
piece.
It's not a contentious
and,
issue.
And we will say our piece. So just give her the floor, and then we will respectfully take the floor as well. Thank you.
Okay. And we got rain coming, so,
so
let's get to the point.
I'm almost done with
so
my
yes,
story, not telling you as to why this event started. So in December when that happened, I said, I'm not going to rent this house again, and I would like to have it as a some kind of public place where everybody can come and enjoy the peace and regain the balance back. If I could do that, I would be happy to. I don't need to sell this place and make money or rent it and get them make money. This is what I would like to do. So that's where the temple started. And I think I'm going to stop here because you understand now about the background. I just wanted to tell you about it because I don't get an opportunity to meet you all on an everyday basis. And I truly appreciate all of you coming today and standing here. And, you know, I feel like I'm just in the middle of a great big family. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you one and all. So any questions that you may have, please ask.
I have one.
Yes, sir.
You bought the house for your family, and now you're going to turn it into a church. Your parking lot that you're looking at, about 130 cars. I mean, you can see what it did to this neighborhood already. Just coming down, if you haven't seen it, I recommend you go drive out, get a golf cart, go look at what it looks like in the top of this neighborhood. And then all this traffic going through this neighborhood, I just don't think this is the right place for your temple. We don't want to stop you from having your temple. All we're asking you to do is not doing it in a residential area. And if you look here, you can see there's going to be a lot of people fighting this. So I'm just saying to you, we love you to be our neighbor. We have no problem with you being the neighbor. You can bring your family here. But we don't want it to turn it into a traffic nightmare for all.
Can we do this? Stop.
Would you like to answer the question?
Yes, please.
Okay, let her answer the question. Okay.
I manage a temple in Evansville. I've been doing that for 3 years now. So what we do in Evansville is, like, it is in a residential neighborhood where the place is. It's actually used to be a banquet hall, and we turned it into the temple. It has over 100 parking spots. And what we do is, when the neighbors have events or something, they come and ask, like, he may have a graduation party of his son. My neighbor may have a graduation party or a 50th birthday party or something like that. They may come and just say, hey, do you have any event on that day for the temple? Can we use the parking lot part of it? We block that parking lot off and let them use it, because temple is supported by the community and it is there for the community. So we let them do that. And there's a golf course next door, and they come when they have golf tournaments. They use our parking lot. When we have an event at the temple that needs additional parking.
We have a right to speak.
Hi. Everybody, my name's Susan Santa, and I'm here as a lifelong resident, a concerned citizen, and a property owner in one of the affected existing multicultural subdivisions. I have long enjoyed the peace and tranquility of this area for 46 years, it being comprised of single family homes. The meaning of peace and tranquility has evolved over time as more and more of you want to share the same environment. I believe this too is why Dr. Satoor has so enjoyed her property. By clearing land, trees, adding an 11,000 square foot building along with asphalt, this will be the opposite effect of what we all desire. I would be equally opposed to a non-religious use that is so obviously out of the scope of the land use plan for the area and is so out of scale for the neighborhood. The proposed use will have an adverse impact on the area with increased traffic, noise, lighting, parking, and not to mention a possible negative impact on property values. Dr. Satoor bought this property entering into a legal binding contract with complete knowledge of the current zoning and restrictive covenants applying to the land parcel. She then transferred the property to her LLC with the same knowledge and the same contract. No one is asking anyone to place any arbitrary or unnecessary restrictions on Dr. Satoor. These are all restrictions that we each agreed to when purchasing our property in the respective subdivisions. This property was purchased by Dr. Satoor and used as intended as a single family residence. This property has already been granted special permissions in the past, allowing for the horses for the enjoyment of the landowner. This special use was granted, however, it did not generate additional traffic nor a nuisance to the neighbors. A conditional use permit is an exception that allows use of a property in a way not permitted by the current zoning law. However, in this case, if allowed, it could negatively affect the surrounding properties which go against allowing conditional use permits. Laws are aimed at protecting property owners, preventing government from abandoning neutrality, and preventing discrimination. Claiming a need for a religious building in this particular location does not mean that there are not more suitable locations within close proximity that won't threaten neighbors' current ways of life. Approval of this would actually be more representative of a spot zoning. In the application, there have already been claims made that a denial of her rights, which you already are attempting to place neighbors in a losing situation. RLUIPA, which is Religious Land Use and Incarcerated Persons Act, in this instance is being provided as a legal weapon against her neighbor's property rights. Preferences by the government for religion is forbidden by the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment and approval of this illogical proposal would indicate that the government is favoring religion over other fundamental rights. Already stating that you don't, if you don't get your way, you plan to take it to the courts, does nothing but guarantee that these local taxpayers will have to foot the bill while it empowers you at our expense. You're asking for something that would serve a population outside of these subdivisions, and therefore, since all attendees would travel by car, there is no undue hardship, as an equally proximate location could just as easily be driven to. You state there would be limited hours. However, once, if the building were approved, that could change. You claim 100 families. However, you said yourself, no one will be turned away. You claim worship will be primarily indoors, which means that some practices or festivals will be outdoors. Denial of this will not adversely compromise the rights of Dr. Satoor to practice her faith, as she lives in Indiana, where she states she has built another temple. The request for this is not representative of the current local population residing in the immediate area. There is no substantial burden, as there are many parcels of land that could more sensibly serve such a development. Denial of this request would not economically burden the owner, as she states in her own application, there are other, more reasonable uses for the property. Reasonable neutral zoning conditions and restrictions are already in place, and any rights granted under the claim of RLUIPA does not relieve the obligation of any government agency to comply with valid, neutral laws of general applicability. Approving this request simply to appease a feeling Dr. Satoor has will contradict constitutional and traditional common sense.
Susan, thank you, Susan, for so eloquently saying what I think everybody here is thinking and believing. And I'll go back to the tranquility. The reason I moved here with my wife 3 years ago was the exact same reason you were here. And it's because of the trees and the water and the nice neighbors and everything else. And so, and I agree with Susan in that by disrupting that and building a large, what will amount to a commercial development, even though you probably don't think so, it will come under the commercial development codes, regulations like fitness or like the life fire safety code and all the other regulations. This is like putting a QT station or a retail station or a retail store or a commercial building in the middle of this neighborhood. That's not likely to happen at Sugarloaf Country Club or any of the major predominant club neighborhoods. So you know, so that's why we moved up here, for the same tranquility you found. You just happened to find it once you were here, like we did. So. And I hope you respect that. Where I'm coming from, my name's Eric Bott. I'm a developer builder. I have built a Hindu temple. I've been involved with Hindus. I've been built mosques. I'm a non-denominational builder. I've built all over the city of Atlanta. I have a lot of Indian friends. I have no, this isn't a religious thing to us. This is a commercial development, wrong use, in the wrong spot.
Absolutely.
One of the reasons I'm here to talk, and I've talked to Dr. Satoor privately, I've talked with her and her attorney privately, and I'm coming from a development side of things. And so when she supplied on the last page of her request a copy of a sample concept plan, did everybody sort of see that? That showed two driveways, or two potential driveways, and the two parking lots and all that. Just to kind of give you a little impact on it, there's a creek. If everybody was walking down the end of the at the road, there is a creek there. That is considered a state waterway. Now, it's not on Dr. Satoor's plans. Now, I don't know if she knows about this. She knows about the creek. However, I've consulted with the people I need to consult with, and that is a state-protected waterway, 75 feet each way. That would effectively negate her entrance from Mercedes Drive. It would also take out part of her first parking lot. So that's a state-mandated rule. That's not my power, that's not the county power, that's the state and the Army Corps of Engineers who's going to dictate what happens on that one. So that's issue one. Issue two is there is an easement that runs right about where you guys are standing for a water line. And so there's a water line running through here. So that's yet to be determined what would happen to that, but potentially it runs right through where her septic system would be designed. And you can't allow, septic cannot run where the water line goes. You have to have an easement and you have to have certain distances between it. So that's sort of strike two, the way I see it. Number three is in the covenants for Bald Ridge of Lanier. Section three, it clearly states that the permitted use is residential houses only with detached garages and guest houses and that sort of thing, but certainly not what she's planning in a commercial building setting. So if it had to go back through, and I'm the president of an association of an office park, restrictive covenants on an association are sometimes more restrictive than local, city, county government restrictions. So, and I've talked to the people at the county, so that's another hurdle that you're gonna have to jump, is that you have an association that has deed restrictions that are in your application that clearly state you can't do this. You can't build a commercial development. Now, if you wanted to build a residential looking, you know, something that's residential looking, then could be a different story. But the fact that you want to build an 11,000 square foot temple, and you and I discussed the design of it, that you said it would have the Hindu symbols and the look of a typical Hindu temple. Is that correct? It would have that look and feel?
Sure.
Okay. So with that being said, I doubt it would pass any architectural committee in any of the subdivisions. So. So just based on that, I question whether the county can even vote on this, because they can't supersede us or supersede Bald Ridge on Lanier covenants. So what happens in that? And there's a whole lot of legal questions, people, the regard that this goes way up the totem pole. And I've been developing for 17 years. I've seen it all. I've done it all. I've been on her side trying to get something rezoned. I've been on the opposite side. So I speak from experience. So that's really the big issue there, is the easements, the setbacks. There's an issue with this. There's a dammed up pond over here, which I don't know if you know, but it's illegal the way it's dammed up currently.
Mr. Matheson has done it.
So,
David Matheson, the first owner of this property.
But as the owner, now, you
right,
would
so
have
we
to.
We haven't changed anything on that side.
I know, but if this ever got to that point, that whole thing would have to be looked at by the Army Corps of Engineers, because it dumps right into Lake Lanier. The other thing, which the UDC, Unified Development Code, is everybody familiar with the design code for Forsyth County?
Yeah.
Is she has stated, Dr. Satoor has stated, that the occupancy would be roughly 100 families times four people per family, and that's how you came up with 400. Is that roughly correct? Okay. However, the occupancy load is set by the fire marshal. So based on the footprint of the building, and when you're doing assembly, and right now I'm doing two churches, I deal with this all the time. If you have a place of assembly or church, and there is no fixed seating, okay, no pews, so like a Catholic church with pews versus a church that would either stand, sit, or put chairs like this out, they have different common denominators. So you would take the square footage of the praying area of the hall and divide by 7.5 if you have non-fixed seating. Well, if you just take her 11,000 square feet, let's assume a couple thousand square feet is bathrooms and hallways and things that aren't gonna count, roughly 8,000 or 9,000 square feet. That puts the occupancy load above 1,000. So the fire marshal is going to say the occupancy load is 1,000. Using the UDC, divide by 4, section 17.3, that's 250 parking spots that are required, which there's no way the site can support. So, and again, so when you look at those two, three, four things, I feel that we have a strong enough case to fight this just on the grounds of permitting, submittal, fire safety, you name it. So there's a lot of other issues. I've got these questions are gonna be provided to everybody. I'll post them online if we need to. And the county, her attorneys will get it. The county's attorneys will get it. Yes, ma'am?
Are you able to test it on Texas on Forsyth as well?
I can, if you want me to. Yes. And so just honestly, based on a purely developmental side, if Dr. Satoor had come to me and said, hey, can you build on this property? And I had to look at all of these issues, I would have said, look somewhere else. And that's my recommendation.
actually was interested.
I'm sorry, hang on. Did somebody have questions for me?
I wanted you to mention about the dump truck.
Okay, yeah, real quick, one thing. Based on the grade, based on her roadway coming in flat off of the, which she can't even do now because she's got to go over the creek, but let's assume that problem wasn't there. Based on the grade from, everybody knows how far it is from here to the top of the hill, right? Everybody can kind of gauge that? To do that, you'd have to have a retaining wall completely around all the parking lot, around the building and everything else. Probably well in excess of 1,000 feet, 20 foot tall. Just doing quick math, three acres. 150,000 square feet, 20 foot tall, is 300,000 cubic feet of dirt. Divide that by 27,000, or 27, is 100,000 cubic yards of dirt. Turns into 10 to 12,000 truckloads, dump trucks of dirt. Okay, running in and out of here just to bring the site up. Now, her engineers could balance the site a little bit, maybe get it to 15 feet, but water doesn't go uphill. Detention ponds are required. The detention pond is gonna be in this upper corner. So if she lowered the site, how do you get water back into a pond that is uphill? So
put some on Chrysler Street.
Huh? Yeah, I guess you do. And so, and again, that the it would tear up the main roads. I mean, the one road we have paved. The one road that we have paved would probably not end up being paved by the time it's done. It would take roughly, doing the math on it, 10 loads, 10 an hour, do the math. We're talking 2 to 3 months around the clock.
200 trucks a day.
Well,
and there goes our train.
Yeah, and the other thing real quick, and it's addressed in this, is the other obvious question is obviously safety, driving. You know, we have a bad left-hand turn from Pilgrim Point to Pilgrim Mill. It's a blind spot.
I live on Pilgrim.
Huh?
I live on Pilgrim.
Yeah.
And one thing about this property is serene and quiet, but it won't be once all the trees are cut down.
Well, and the county will require a complete recompense, which is what means they have to replant, but they're never going to replant a tree that's 2 foot in diameter. They're going to plant a 3-inch tree.
They won't grow enough. I live right there. They'll never grow fast
enough. So,
and what about fireworks?
Well,
I mean, because I know that's part of your religion. No, you wouldn't be doing any fireworks?
We usually don't do them at the temple unless if we do them for one day of the year and for Diwali or lights function. We usually have a sheriff to come by and stay there in the property, and for the most part we limit them to the sparklers for the kids and the little flower pots. We don't do the ones that are noisy because it scares the young kids. So that's what we do at the current temple that I'm in. So that's, if at all we do it, that's all we're planning to do. I actually
have the status of this project right now.
I'm sorry?
How is this project going to proceed? Are the neighbors going to be requested to vote on it?
No,
does
no.
The county when, vote on it first?
Do you mind if I answer this? Because I answer pretty
quick.
All right, the way it's going to work is this is the first public hearing. Okay, she may come back from here and go, nah, I'm not fighting a battle. Done. She drops her case and moves on. If she decides to move on, she has to answer all of the questions we've posed to her. Now, we may not like the answers. She's going to answer them. Her attorney's going to answer them. They will then, if they think they have enough information to go to a hearing or a to the commissioner for a vote, if they've got all their ducks in a row and they've answered questions, but there's a lot of questions. One of the questions is, we want to see the building, we want to see the footprint, that dictates occupancy. We're talking months of getting through. Once that hearing happens, they can either deny it, they can abstain from it, they can push it to another month, they want more information. This could go as quick as the end of the year, or depending on the back and forth, it could be, I've seen them go for several years, so.
Ma'am, all due respect, you know.
And I'm gonna step out, they let them ask questions.
Ma'am, when you first came here, you found peace and serenity. Ma'am, please, I'm just asking a question. When you said at start that you found peace and serenity in this place when you first seen it, I believe every one of us did too. But you're going to try to cause us to all be grieved and disrupted through our lives for your benefit, because that's selfishness.
Yes.
That's not being fair to any of your neighbors.
Sell my house and I can't get it above what I bought for, how are we all going to how is that going to work?
What we have, I'm speaking from my experience being in Evansville, managing the temple for 3 years.
I'm from Indiana.
I understand.
I'm from Indiana. I
know
so Evansville has nothing to do with this.
I'm speaking from my experience. That's what I'm saying. The place that actually the temple is in right now, the property values were lower 3 years ago because there was a symmetry across the street.
Symmetry
that's close by. It is in a subdivision, actually. And there's a symmetry close by, so people weren't wanting to move and buy the houses over there.
Excuse me. The area is so beautiful, but they have weddings.
So what happens is like the property values in past 3 years went up very well, that people actually wanted to move in and buy houses. So from what I have seen happening around the temple is that there were new developments coming in and people wanting to move in, because Eric actually can vouch for that. Eric is a builder and he has known builders that built houses close to the temple, develop subdivisions close to the temple, because most of the Indians are like me. When they immigrate, they have knowledge workers.
We already live here.
But I immigrated legally, just like you all.
I know, but how can you sit here and say in this statement the benefit of the property owner from the grant of rights to grant the subject faith of the property outweigh any impacts of other properties? How can you say that? That's not true.
Wait,
it's not true. You're saying that it's better for you than it is for us. What the hell with us?
Dr. Satoor and her attorney get together and feel that they have answered all of these issues. There's a whole lot of issues.
Yes.
I promise you that, I hate to say this, you're going to have your work cut out for you.
Fine, don't worry. I have plenty of time.
Good.
I have a question.
Stop.
I have a question.
Let him answer my question.
Are you going to be an absentee owner?
No.
You're going to move back to Georgia?
I will be managing both places.
Can we let Eric answer
so
my question?
I'm going to be here on the weekends, and my son actually started college at Georgia Tech, so he's going to be full-time manager for this place. And I'll be coming, and I'll be in and out managing both that temple over there and the temple. It's a subsidiary.
Let him talk.
The couple of temples that you own in Indiana.
One,
okay. My understanding is that two of the temples in that area were built in very remote areas, basically no infrastructure around them. The third one was built in a commercial area.
We only have two temples. I don't know where you got that information. They're in the middle of the residential. I can tell you. 6299 Oak Grove Road. You can go ahead and Google it and you'll find the address. 6299 Oak Grove Road, New
York. I'm one of the ones who welcomed you here with open arms when you moved into this house. I've been your neighbor for over 10 years.
As we have.
You're still welcome. You're still very welcome here, you and your family. But your temple is right behind my house. How am I going to feel every morning or every Sunday and Saturday?
Right.
I'm hearing traffic go up and down your road before it's in the parking lot.
Sir.
The horns, voice talking. When am I going to get rest
and
get relaxed?
Are you going to have parking
the
lot
lights? The water runoff, the lake. I mean,
I am right here. I'm
do you
right
hear
here.
The horns all
yes,
the time?
I am.
You
I hear you coming down the driveway
know
right
where
now.
We live.
I can hear cars coming down this driveway right now.
I can hear 400
you can't
from my
see
home.
My house from the
I can't see your house, but I can hear
sound. Everything goes on back here when it goes on.
When the leaves are down, it's going to be worse.
There's nothing to keep people out of this property.
You take the trees out, it's going to be even worse. That's not peaceful to kill the trees.
We're not taking any trees.
You're not taking, I'm not talking about anywhere.
Trees.
That's not peaceful. That's not a peaceful thing. I don't know what you're thinking.
I live in the first house in Pilgrim Bay subdivision. I can tell you there's 4 four-way stop signs because everybody, I go to a lot of states, a lot of festivals and stuff, and I meet people from all over the states, and everybody knows, oh, you live that place where all the car names. They don't, that's all they say. And I tell, and it's coming in, it's very easy, but we've been there 15 years. Lynn sold me that house 15 years ago. Hey, Lynn. and I feel like the new kid on the block, honestly. And we moved there 15 years. I was at my house for 30 years before I got married. 29, actually. That's the first house I ever owned. That's the only house I'll ever have. I don't want to have to sell it for... I want to stay there 30 years, 40 years. And that's where I want to be. And but between the last month, ever since the signs went up, every few days there's been people coming, turning around, going in the property, turning around. Today, I mean, there's been at least 20 or 30 cars today. Just come in. Where are we parking?
Because of
the traffic.
And we even received some phone calls that weren't very pleasant.
Okay. Well,
we only have one way in and one way out. Our subdivision.
You're wanted here.
Yeah, you and your family.
Temple. You're fine.
We don't mind you.
Oh, we don't mind.
You bring several friends for the weekend.
And here's the thing. If somebody is threatening you, let us know so we can make sure the police take care of it.
Absolutely.
Those people are not.
Absolutely.
We want you here. Right. We want your children.
We want you here.
So
as a family.
Mike and Donnie and Kevin bought some horses.
We just said we're not a thing. We just created your own.
Absolutely.
I have a question.
We don't want anything with nothing.
I understand you have people of your own that you want to care for, but does it matter to you that all of these people are opposed to this?
What about these people?
Do you care about any of us? All of you can all welcome any time to come in. They could meditate in a gazebo in a park. I've been to India 5 times, and I know you don't need a temple to meditate.
Stand there and smile about it. That's fine.
Your community is telling you this is not what they're doing.
This is the community. You keep mentioning community.
Yes,
this is it.
I've been to many times.
This is your community.
Are you trying to convert
this
community?
You know what?
You're
trying to destroy the peace of this world. You're trying to destroy the peace of this world. Because taking down all the trees and cementing it over is not a good thing.
Can you answer the question so everybody can hear?
Hey guys,
let's all hear the answer.
It's getting out of hand.
Let her answer real quick.
I haven't actually answered any questions about the building plan as such. What you're looking at behind me, this house, is over 4,000 square feet is what I was told. I haven't had, I don't remember the exact numbers. So a temple of 10,000 square feet, you're looking at twice as big as this house. That's what you're looking at. I understand I could take Eric's advice. I can take, Bible said take the difficult way, right? Don't take the Bible way. Having said that, I can take Eric's advice. If possible, I can take Eric's advice and give this to a multi-family, somebody like a builder, and say, you can put a multi-family, you can put the houses,
just say, no.
But that will bring down your home values, and why would I want to put my you can put a multi-family here and bring down all of your serenity and home values. And why would I want to do that? You guys are my
neighbors.
One at a time, guys.
Guys, let us talk.
By ruining our peace and tranquility, doesn't that
I'm
matter?
I'm not ruining anybody's peace and tranquility.
Yes, you are. You are. Oh, everybody, look.
Yes.
Look what it's doing. Just talking about.
We all have our different way of articulating our opinions.
Yes.
But is this not sufficient?
This is emotional. This is our homes. This is where we raise our families. And you want to bring this in here?
I don't
understand.
Nothing.
Let Ben talk.
My name is Ben. I live on the corner of Chrysler and Pilgrim Point. That big yard right there. The beautiful part about this is it's like a cul-de-sac in a subdivision. There's only one way in and one way out. And whenever there's traffic coming by, I see it all the time. I have two little girls I like to play outside. Good. And whenever cars are coming back and forth, they just blow through the stop sign.
Yeah.
The lanes are too narrow for two vehicles to get by. With the construction that's going on here, it's just a hazard. I like being here because it's like living in a cul-de-sac. It's a natural cul-de-sac. We're surrounded by the lake. But whenever you put a structure that brings a lot of traffic into a road that can't handle it, and there's one way in, one way out, then we have a problem with that.
How much traffic actually happens in this area, and also how much traffic does the temple bring in? Because I'm looking at the statistics of the other temples in the local area and see how much traffic it comes in. I was talking to actually somebody in south side of Atlanta about the Hindu temple of Atlanta is in Riverdale. I was talking to one of the founders, and in the very beginning when the thought came in, I spoke to them and asked them, since I don't live in this area, it would be less of a burden for me. I could donate the land to you guys. You can have the house and the land together. You can do the temple part. I don't have to worry about it. He said, we have one temple. We're having a hard time managing it because people don't want to come unless we have an event, a specific event, a special event that we have to put it out there and do some publicity and all. People don't want to come to the temple. It's not like a church where on a Sunday morning everybody wants to go to the church and sit there and listen to the ceremony. Hindu temples are different. You don't necessarily have to go to the temple.
You don't know our religions. We
you
don't
can
even
go
talk religion.
And do you pray, like say, thank you, Lord. Lord, I really need a new car. Please, can you please help? And
will you
that's
change the
amount
application
of prayers that we usually. I'm sorry.
Will you change the application?
I just think traffic is so consistent. One day a week.
Yeah. The reason that we didn't want to do that is because of the fire marshal thing again. You know, because I don't mandate those things. If we ask for a building of certain size, because in Indian temples you have seen it, right? In Indian temples, you have seen the architecture, how it is like, where there is a sanctum for everybody. It's not like a church where you have somebody sits on the stands on the podium like me, and everybody kind of sits around. It's like every god or goddess has their own room. So that room itself takes some space because they are like, you know, they have to have their own design and all that. So I actually had people from India to come and look at the site. What I told them very specifically when they're designing this temple is, do the least amount of disturbance to the land. The least amount possible, we're going to do it. The smallest temple that would fit the needs, we're going to build. The minimum amount of parking spots, we're going to build. You have to understand this. I am financing this temple. Okay?
Are you financing our home?
So,
this young man over here has been waiting quite a while to ask a question.
You're drop dead in the middle of two neighborhoods. You're affecting hundreds and hundreds of people. I'm not being disrespectful.
No,
I'm not being rude.
I'm going to put the temple. People are going to move around there. And there are going to be neighborhoods all around it.
Neighborhood is here. What did you not understand about that? The neighborhood is here.
Everything is for sale. I'm just trying to smash an answer.
Say about this workplace, right? I already explained to you why this place, why here. I could take
the
money
and
do
something. We all have the same. We all have the same.
This man right here has been waiting patiently to ask everybody.
I can't get all these things. I haven't seen the piece in my own house in McDonough. So that's why I came here looking for it. So if this place is the one that specifically gives the peace to the people, I want to do the least amount of disturbance to anything. And Eric talked about 12,000 dump trucks. And I talked to the engineer and he laughed at me. He literally laughed at me and he said, who said this? I don't know. I'm not an engineer. I'm just a doctor. Okay? I am just a doctor. I understand.
Give,
I went to the business
school. Give your engineer
school.
My car.
I'm just a doctor.
as your engineer, seeing the property.
Because we have to do it anyways, no matter what. So I took all the questions from Eric and said, I'm going to prepare answers for all this when we submit to the county. Because we want to be fair. We want to do everything right. Because this is a temple. We want to do everything as it should be.
What are you going
to
do when the parking lot fills up? Where's people going to park then?
When
your parking lot fills up because you don't have a limit.
Let the man speak.
We're all adults here. Let's just cut the BS. We can argue laws and code. Let's just cut the BS. Obviously, a lot of people don't want this to happen. You obviously have a lot of money. people you're working with obviously have a lot of money.
Yes.
God, whatever God you believe in, created all of this. Are you seriously telling me that God is saying that this place is any better than any other place that he created? There's no other place that would be more accommodating to what you want to do. Even in the same county, there's nowhere else this could go. It has to be right here. You can't put it anywhere else.
Well, I can spend a neighborhood where the people are going to be attending
you. Yeah, they're on Freedom Parkway. Freedom Parkway.
Yeah, Cuckoo's Nest. Oh, the God created the earth, the earth's magnetic field or whatever that stuff that has happened there, like the cows roaming, the cows is roaming, brings some kind of energies to the place that not every place can see a cycle, you know, at least. I can tell you that.
And they got okay. Office space.
Wait, you guys stop. You guys stop. Let him talk and
look,
then.
It comes down to this. This is what it comes down to. The property, I built my whole life. This piece of property does not suit what you want to do, first off, the photography. Just, I mean, you can throw money at it all you want to, but it's going to cost a lot of money to do this property. But the number one thing, it does not conform with the use of this property. And you have two sets of rules that's covering you. One is the homeowner association rules, the covenants, protective, that you signed in the very beginning. You're going against everything that you stood there and signed for whenever you try to do this to this piece of property. You're doing it to every one of these folks.
Do you think I have not looked at those things?
Well, then why are you standing here doing this? You're looking at every one of these folks that had the same feeling whenever you walked up here and said, "Oh Lord, look at this." They did the same thing on their property. Look at the deer. Mm-hmm. And now you're wanting to bring them in here, and I don't care about anything. You don't have the right of way to come in here like you're supposed to. You don't have the water system in here like you're supposed to have a commercial business back here, and that's what it is. Yep. You will have to rezone this, and I'll tell you, look these faces good, because you're going to see them at every meeting you have.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's next. Okay. Ma'am?
I appreciate that, but let me just quickly answer your question. We looked at all those covenants. We looked at everything before we even came up with this project. So it's an answer.
I have been very respectful. Not just to you. I've listened to all them. I am a builder. But with that said,
can you speak louder?
The very first thing you said when you got up here and spoke was, "I came here. I felt the love, I felt the community, y'all all welcomed me in. I don't live in here, but I live down here." And you've looked at every one of these people and said, "What I want, crap on y'all."
That's selfish. Yeah. Yeah.
And you're telling all these people, "You need to respect you," which I do. But you're telling all this, "I don't respect you. I don't respect your home. I don't respect why you live here. I don't respect why you moved here. And I don't respect all your peace and tranquility." Because they're telling you, I'm listening to it, they're telling you nothing against you. Please do not disrupt our peace and tranquility. Please go somewhere else.
You already are.
But they're telling you their reaction. What you're doing is not what they want.
We have been to the temples. We have seen the temples. We have seen how many were there at the temples. And you have seen the peace and quiet. And what makes you live with that if there's a peaceful temple coming here is going to make you
the parking lot. Traffic.
We have a septic tank. Sewer is not the issue.
It's not suited for the single family septic tank that you're going to put 400 to 1,000 people using it.
So tell me how that's going to work.
Let me tell you, the temple that I manage actually right now is on Samaritan. And the owner, when the previous owner that actually built the temple was a banker, she said she had the septic tank completed 2 weeks. And right now, the situation is they come and look at the septic tank, the tank and leave. And we get it pumped once a year. And she was amazed because it's not even filling up. Because
but a banquet house.
When they go to the temple, they don't have the bathroom separately. They feel like it's a God's place.
Oh my God.
I understand, you know, it's a cultural thing.
But a banquet house.
If I go with him,
yes.
I try not to as much as I can. It's a God's house. I'm going over there. Unless I have dowry, I can control it. Instead of messing up my friends, I would go. But Hindus, when they go to the temple, they consider that as a God's holy place, they respect it, they don't throw the trash everywhere, they don't use the trash unless they really need to. They kind of, you know, they feel like it's a God's house.
Okay. But a banquet house is a commercial property to begin with.
But I have seen the difference, that's what I'm saying. So from what Miss Linda told me versus what I'm seeing, I see a difference. And from there, I have to just speak from my experience as to what it is. Yes, ma'am.
I'm much older than probably half the people around here.
And I appreciate you being
almost
here today.
Almost 25 years. I live 2 houses off Pilgrim Point. To this gentleman, I call the police every fall because of the people blowing the stop sign at Olds and Pilgrim Point.
Yes.
Infrastructure. This is not about religion. It is about infrastructure. We have a 2-lane road out there.
Barely.
I drive a Ford Fiesta. If you're not familiar with it, you might not be. It is a very small car. I regularly move over almost to the post box because of the trucks going through. And I had to do that. If you could go out there tonight, you would see that if we had a fire, the fire truck could not get to them. None of these roads are large enough for the kind of volume of traffic. And yes, you say there's only going to be a couple of cars. You're talking about an 11,000 square foot place. I might be old, but I can have some track. There's going to be a heck of a lot more cars on a continuous basis. And that's why I'm objecting. I don't see anybody in here objecting because it's a temple. It wouldn't matter if it was a parish or a congregational church or whatever. It just will not. We don't have the infrastructure, and we're not going to have the infrastructure. His children walk on the street. His children catch the bus on the street.
Yes.
On the street. I cringe every fall that there is going to be a child hit on that street.
How many accidents do they happen to you? Like, do they have a count of those? Does anybody know?
I don't.
How many accidents?
Hundreds. We live here. We try to respect each other. Literally hundreds.
Not and I have watched my neighbors.
Must have had a count.
I have watched my neighbors run out in the street.
Accidents that happens on this Pilgrim Point Road.
Will you withdraw the application? Would you withdraw the application?
Yes. It's the guard's work. I can't do it. It has to come from him.
Yeah. Mike's been waiting for us.
I do have one question.
We have one question over here.
If it was my project, I'm with you guys. You know, if somebody says, oh, stop it, I'm like, oh, man, it's my project, I can stop. But it is the good Lord's work. He's the one that gave the instruction that, you know, this place should be shared.
We're getting a different message.
Please, be my guest and do that. Because do you know how hard it is to drive from Evansville to here?
I done it.
What if we move on here every weekend?
8 hours drive. And can you imagine me being a gastroenterologist coming here every weekend and doing this? And I'm 45 years old. I'm not a 20-year-old anymore. And when this project came along, I said, Lord, are you serious about this? Because
you're gonna drive
I'm an
down
old person, an old person. You know? And he said, no. He said, I want you to do it and I want you to share because you cannot keep this to yourself. You have to share. This place has to be shared and this is the time. Go for it.
Eric, what is the process for us to help? Stop.
Well,
that's the best I could say.
All right, Dr.
Well, that's not enough. Wait.
I have one question.
Then I'm going to...
Okay, on James Burgess Road, there's a Shirty Side Temple. The temple was originally built with a certain amount of parking. The parking spaces were extended after that point. And now, even at this point, there are multiple signs up and down James Burgess for no parking on the shoulders because of the number of religious people coming into that temple, which is certainly understandable. How do you expect this area to be any different? And once you, if you are granted, if by some chance you're granted the 113 parking spaces and the temple grows, what's going to happen at that point? Is there going to be an amendment to that? Are we going to try to move on and build more parking spaces? Or are they going to be parking on the driveway? Or as the lady pointed out very succinctly, up on the street where you can't get emergency personnel in and out? That's one of the questions, one of the problems that we see happen.
I understand. We looked at that issue in the very beginning about, you know, the population growth, which is expected to happen in Atlanta and everywhere. Population is growing, so we can help that. The two-lane highway is now turning into three-lane highway, the 400, up until past this point, which used to be two-lane. When we looked at all these issues, we said it's a small track, so we're going to confine ourselves. I know James Burgess has, like, and they have a large a congregation, so to speak, of Shirdi Sai. That's actually a similar kind of temple for the same God that I manage in Edinburgh. But we have found ways around managing the traffic where we had, like in the Temple of Atlanta does now, Eric, when they have a special occasion, when they're expecting, like, say, 500 cars, if they don't have space, they tie up with the local schools because these occasions happen on the weekends, not so much in the weekdays because people have to come. They're all working. So what they do is they go ahead and, just give me one second, get your hand out. I don't want your hand to hurt. South of
me. Right, so you're saying you will not add parking spaces. You'll go to a school and meet up and come
up. What we will do is, you know that Indians drive minivans, right? That's what we do for the Hindu Temple of Atlanta. I used to be the minivan driver. One of those minivans where they had the local schools that they tie up with and say, you know, can we use your parking lot for the weekend? And volunteers like me who would just go in and just, you know, just drop the parents, the fathers would come, drop off everybody. Mothers would come, drop off everybody at the temple. They go park. We bring like five or six parents.
So no parking lot needed then?
Exactly. No, parking lot is needed because we cannot have the volunteer help on a regular basis. We have to have some that way. We don't have, people shouldn't be parking outside. We're going to have the police to post no parking signs all around the property. That way, if anybody happens to park, they can get towed away. We can call them and then have them towed away because we don't want to take the risk of throwing away somebody's car without posting the sign. And also the neighbors should, you know, if you have any occasions that you really need to use the parking lot, you're welcome to use it. That's what we do at the temple in Evansville. We'll be happy to do that.
All right, can I know it's getting close to wrapping it up.
I'm sorry, one second.
No, go ahead.
I don't want, please.
Actually, I just want to make a couple comments. I'm not sure the Hindu population in Forsyth County or the area, and you have mentioned quite a bit tonight God and faith and serenity. I would like that some people that represent this neighborhood get a chance to go to your temples and plead our case to the worshipers. And I'd also suggest that they be asked to come down here, look at our neighborhood, and ask their hearts, is this what they want to do? Is that really what you want to do? I'm a religious person, but I'm not going to use God and faith and all that stuff just to take advantage of people. Are they worshiping God?
Thank you. Amen. Amen.
There is a financial aspect to this. All right, talking to Dr. Satoor, correct me if I'm wrong in any of this. Your plan is to sell 100 either founder memberships or memberships or donations to upstart this, so you'd have 100 families at $25,000. Is that the...
That's how the Hindu Temple of Atlanta did it. Like they have, you know, they set up a membership fee high, That way, many people won't sign up, and many people won't have vested interest into that. But having said that, you have to offer some, because there has to be some kind of succession planning. Because once I pass, and I'm only here for like however many years of my life, and then somebody has to pick up the baton and continue the temple. So there are two ways of doing it. There are like different temples have different rules. Like in India, what we have done is like we have committee-owned temples. We have actually a temple that are done by the founders. Like a founder like me starts a temple, and my family will pick up next, and then, you know, be the major one of in the board. That way they direct, like, you know, this is what my grandmother said that she this temple should be like.
So you'll have
guys, stop. Let Eric continue.
Let me. Okay.
Everybody, hold on 1 minute, please.
Listen.
Where I'm going.
It's nice to see another Indian family, somebody here that could have shed some light into that. I don't see anybody here.
We don't have any.
I guess I'm the only Indian family in this multicultural community.
Okay. That was rude. Because we have, there's many people, there's lots of cultures here. For you to sit here and say, supposedly this is a multicultural family area, this absolutely is. But just because there's more white faces does not mean that this has anything to do with race at all. There are multi-families. She was just speaking Spanish behind you.
Yeah.
So there are Indian families are more than welcome here. But to this point, nobody has moved in here. So you can't sit there and say that this has something to do with, oh, well, I haven't seen any Indian people here, and that would be nice. We just said it would be nice if anybody like that came here so they could hear us out. So that was very rude of you, and I'm offended. I'm very offended. And let me know if you guys feel the same way. If anyone has threatened you because of your religion, please let us know, because we will get the sheriff right on that. It has nothing
Amen.
to do with it.
That because my family is going to be here and my employees will be working in this place, and I feel like I have a vested interest in explaining stuff, but another Indian could have shed some more light into that, saying this is how it is like, and you know, this is what we do, so you will understand, you will get an impartial view of the situation.
What you don't understand is we're concerned about the cars and the traffic.
May I ask
one question? Why here? Why on this property? There's multiple areas on Pilgrim Hill that will accept you 100%.
There's already a church on Freedom Parkway.
You cuckoo's nest. It will take you wholeheartedly. And the parking is there. No, it is not taking you wholeheartedly.
May I ask a valid question? I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Our neighborhood.
Why, if it's for everyone in this neighborhood, why is that orange sign right here at the front of my neighborhood and not up there at Pilgrim Point and Pilgrim Mill Road for every subdivision and all 600 people that don't come four stop signs down to see? I understand it's got to be in front of the property, don't get me wrong, but there should have been another sign out to allow other people that don't come down four stop signs that live in Pilgrim Mill.
That was the county's
point. No, I was just asking the question.
We have to have one.
True that.
That's the county's decision as far
so
as where they place
it. So it went down as to the what the county required. It wasn't anything that I actually decided that this is what it should be like. But it went down with the county requirement.
You're just going to have to talk, man.
Yeah, all right, okay. To answer the question about the signage and what happens, by law, she has to notify. The county tells her attorney what to do. It's within 500 feet of all parcels here and any contiguous property. Okay, so is there anybody here from Baldridge on Lanier representative here?
I know one Shady Short. The property owner did not receive notice. I spoke to him personally,
right.
And he has his home right there. He'll be looking across the coast.
There is. So when this may be a county situation that they did not give you the list, but everybody obviously on Mercedes got it, a few people on Pilgrim Point and around, but there is a property that sits right over the corner of your property that actually is contiguous with you, and there are probably another couple homeowners that from that point out is 500 feet. So, I hate to break it to you, but this meeting we're having right now is going to happen again, because they have to be notified.
They didn't give us any
So I don't, you know, I don't follow those, I don't make those rules.
Okay. Well, that's one issue. Where I was going with the 25,000 and the 100 homes and so on and so forth is, Dr. Satoor and I talked about it, and I've obviously told her what I think it's going to cost to develop this site, and it's between her and her God if she thinks she can afford it. And however, you stated something in your closing remarks there that you said you don't get out of this world alive. You know, you're going to die at some point. We're going to die at some point.
Right.
Your vision dies at some point. So what happens when your vision becomes the next person's vision who says, I want it to be like downtown. I want it to be like Stone Mountain. I want it to be like SSMA, which is the one I built over off of Beaver Ruin, or any of the other ones, that all of a sudden the dream of 100 people becomes a dream of 1,000 people. So what happens when, and to the proverbial, you can't put the genie back in the bottle. In that case, once, and you guys, I'm just telling you right now, you have to have faith. The county, this has to go through so many layers of review between county easements, creeks, car count. We're going to demand a car count for every entrance in and out of this place. And Dr. Satoor, I don't know if you know this, we're considered a substandard neighborhood. We don't have the road system, that's why they're not paid. They can't get the right-of-ways, it would cost too much money, and so other than the main right-of-way that got done a long time ago, I doubt much of it's going to get paved any past this. I mean, we'd love for it to, you know, that. If you can pave all our roads, I'm sure you'd have our boat. I'm kidding.
But this community doesn't support you.
I said community doesn't necessarily mean the community around the house.
But community,
the Atlanta community supports the temple.
You're not supporting the temple.
Support means the ongoing support as far as the maintenance is concerned.
Well, first off,
as far as putting it together is concerned. You know, I understand that if you're my neighbor and she don't like me, and that's okay. But there are like other neighbors. I'm saying, like, you know, this community. This one community doesn't want to support. There's another community wants to come and support. I can't help it. Whoever that wants to come support, supports it. And Eric, talking about the vision that Eric mentioned, there is a way to actually have that managed. Because I have seen many temples, as the time goes, being mismanaged. Churches happen to do the same way. They become like mega churches and like, you know, mega churches. But you have a way to curtail this. This is what is called putting in the bylaws together. Founders puts the bylaws together in such a way that it has to be a tightly controlled shift.
The bylaws.
Yes. The bylaws are
commercial. So you're saying you're going to protect us by putting it in your contract, your bylaws, but it is not being, you're not honoring it. So how are you supposed to implement that with the people that you follow you?
Where did the bylaws say that I should not be asking for a conditional usage permit? Is there something in the bylaws?
Well, here we
my attorney looked at it and he said, I don't see anything in the bylaws that says you cannot ask for.
Well, hang on, guys.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on.
Hey.
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 Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey.
Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey.
Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey.
Hey. Hey.
Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. And I've been to nearly every neighborhood north of the perimeter. And I'll tell you, I have not seen a temple, and most churches are respectful of neighborhoods. They do not plop down right in the middle of a neighborhood. They find a major artery to go to and put their facilities there. They do not try to be intrusive and get into people's neighborhoods. They just simply are not there. If you can tell me where there's one, I'll be glad. But I have been to every neighborhood in 20 years.
Would you like to see
time.
The one on James
Burgess?
No.
You can't even answer the question.
One person talk. In section 3, if I show this to you, and this is the neighborhood you own land in. This is not Shady Shores. This is called Baldridge on Lanier. Section 3. Says all lots in said area shall be used for residential purpose. Structures erected, altered, placed, or permitted on any lot shall consist of only one detached single-family dwelling, not to exceed 2 stories in height, and one accessory building, which may include garage, so on and so forth. So, this is deed restricted. This is what you signed up for when you bought this land. Now, the UDC may or may not allow you to submit. Now, you can try to submit. The county is not going to necessarily stop you from submitting until it gets through this process, gets through the review, gets through a vote, and so on. Which leads to the last piece of this thing, which is...
One second, let me stop you right there.
No.
Let him finish. But it says... It doesn't say anywhere that conditional usage permit should not be...
But you have to understand something. That's not contemplated. This is deed restricted. This is more restrictive than...
So it's not in there.
Let's go ahead. All right, so...
I wanted to make sure.
Okay, no, it's not in there. And the reason it's not in there is that the county has their own rules and regulations, but deed restricted properties, the UDC was put into effect, I don't even know which year, they change it, you know, it's constantly changed and updated based on what's going on in the world.
I believe it was 2011.
2011. These go all the way back to 1983. Okay, so these supersede those, so it wouldn't have to be in there. Now, we'll have a legal question to the lawyers at the county, how they allowed it to get to this point, because really, to be honest, it shouldn't have never gotten to this point. Right. Right. But there's one last thing. Religious land use...
There's the reason why this has happened. Then.
They speak British.
All right. In 2000, our lovely president...
I didn't know, I'm just a doctor, I told you.
Go ahead, Eric.
In 2000, our lovely president, Bill Clinton, signed the Religious Land Use Protection Act, which basically... basically gives all religious types, it doesn't differentiate, and it is supposed to keep them, or supposed to allow everybody equal freedom. Okay, the one thing that's not really contemplated and it's never made to the Supreme Court yet is what about our rights? What about our rights in that? In the sentence, which is section 2A, shows that there must be a substantial burden to a religious organization unless the government can show that it has compelling interest for imposing restrictions. Well, the compelling interest in this situation is we have deed restricted properties.
Right.
So, and that they technically, in my view, talking to my attorneys, they can't really do anything. All they're going to say is what they should just turn it down. And which would force you to court. If you want to go to court, that's your prerogative. And so, but
whatever the artist comes from above, what can I say?
Well, I hope God's got a good one. So based on that, guys, to answer everybody's asked question, what happens next? It's really up to her. Yeah. If she decides to proceed with it, it can go through the county at some point. The county commissioners, we will all be at the same meeting.
Amen.
Plus, what are we going to get to our community if she does go to court and takes the county?
Because the only way that a lot of people got in court was by signs that we put out.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, is there a Facebook page to this?
Yes. If you look on the bottom of the sheet that we handed out, there's a Facebook page. If you go sign up.
Okay, if somebody didn't get that, what?
We'll give it to you.
We'll figure that out.
But there is, we do have a way to communicate. I got it.
There's just somebody.
So the next step, guys, is really up to her. If she decides to pursue it after taking all of these questions to her lawyer, it's really up to them to see if they have defenses against all of the issues that we brought up.
Eric, I have a question. Yeah. So if she does take this to court and with the county, how much is that going to cost the county? And if she loses, does she have to pay back the county?
No, the answer is no. The court, there won't. If she decides to sue, the county has plenty of money. They have deeper pockets than all of us, including her. And so we don't have to worry about the county defending us. That's not an issue. So, and we feel that just on the merits of commercial development, the creeks, the sewers or storm easements, everything going on here, they've got thousands, tens of thousands of dollars just to get answers to find out if it's even feasible or not.
And so
if she decides to go forward, then there will be a hearing. Everybody show up. Everybody wear red.
Red shirt.
Red shirt. Okay. All right. So everybody show up. We'll have better. We'll be a little bit better organized. We're pretty good for putting this together on short notice.
Yes, you were.
And
everybody wear red. And if you want to talk at the hearing, you have to get there 15 minutes early so you can sign your name.
And if you don't talk, make sure you wear red so they know visually that you're against it.
But how are we going to know that
Harry
is?
Okay, here's what will happen. Once she submits it and they accept it, if they accept that it's going to go to the next level, there will be a red sign. I believe it. Okay. That sign will go out. We will make sure there are multiple locations. It'll be, everybody will be notified properly and everybody will go to that hearing. There is five commissioners. Okay. You have to have at least three to vote on it. If two show up, it's a no vote. It's dead. If somebody has to recuse themselves because there's a conflict of interest, they're out. If it's a 2-2 vote, it's dead. Okay.
The planning board first before it gets the commissioners.
Yes.
Well, it'll go through the planning board and all that stuff. Yeah, the planning board's already said no to the second exit coming out on Mercedes, and they're not even gonna look at it until it gets to the planning stages. And I've talked to the planning department. They said, "Give me a plan," but she hasn't submitted one. So once that plan is there, but it has to conform to all commercial development, life safety code, you name it. It's going to be built as if I'm building this thing in downtown Atlanta.
So this
guys,
is a commercial building going in our
state. Every one of you have been great. I haven't heard one negative thing about her religion, her family, her friends. The only thing I've heard anything about has come from the other side. So y'all keep this mindset through this thing.
Yep.
Wear red because that's a blood color. And we know what covers us.
Yeah.
So you wear red to these meetings, and you have somebody that's well-spoken, the lady. Who is she? The lady that spoke earlier.
Miss
read
Banner.
The, yeah. Susan. You get her to get up and read what she read right there.
Susan.
Those guys want to be elected again.
Absolutely.
Well, thank y'all.
We would just like to say thank you to Dr. Satoor. We do appreciate you coming
thank you.
In.
Thank you.
And
young lady up there.
Okay. Yeah, I'm asking my wife.
Please sign the sign-in sheets.
Everybody sign the sign-in sheets when you leave. If you haven't signed in, sign it at the front.
Yes, if you can give me, if you don't write numbers down, well, we're going to put it, yeah.
Your Deerwood HOA?
And I've been there for 15 years, and it wasn't that way when I moved there. So
we've been here 24 years.
Yeah. So it has a lot to do with, kind of the very small.
This kid worked for me, so. Yeah, good luck. You need any help up there?
I think that's something helpful.